This was one of the first videos that I uploaded to YouTube. It showed me making a game in just 2 hours, which must have been what people wanted since it gained over 100,000 views before it was taken down after somebody else uploaded it. Strange. But it gets even stranger, for it was uploaded to a large game making site by James Luke. Who is he? Why is he submitting my games to sites? And why can't he spell? Daily Click has been the biggest site for click games since before I even got a computer. Although there are many admins, Rickus is the big cheese and has loyally, and at some point seemingly single-handedly, kept it up and running. When I first started out, I posted my games to Click Island, a much smaller, friendlier site. Rickus eventually made me admin on it, and I spent many hours as a 13-year-old deleting spam posts from Nerdboy and chatting to a really nice friendly guy called Sensation Prince. The site got taken down and I had no choice but to move to the terrifying and massive Daily Click. I posted on the forums asking for help with Dragon Era Mine 2, and an account called Fizzy replied, saying that he'd do some voices for it.
What's your name?
What a great voice he had.
I know.
But it's hard to deny that things operated slightly differently in his head.
I have my reasons.
The world wasn't ready for his, I guess we'd call it, genius. He often got banned from the Daily Click and would sign up under different usernames, releasing strange games and playing accounts off against each other. The site grew paranoid and began carrying out witch hunts where they accused each other of being fake Fizzy accounts. He's the kind of guy who makes the internet interesting, and continued to make appearances on the Daily Click until people grew suspicious and banned his new personas. Anyway, time to get back on track. I posted a number of my games on the site and the reception wasn't exactly positive. People didn't know how to play the games that had taken me months to make, and they were being given 2 out of 5 ratings, together with unfair and often misleading feedback. It upset me a lot more than it should have done. But you can sort of understand why when other people were getting 5 out of 5 for little demos that had obviously only taken a couple of hours to make. This doesn't just happen with games, by the way. Pretty much every type of media you can think of suffers from the more you try to do, the more there is to criticise. And I was always very ambitious with my games. Red Enchilada submitted a very basic 3D tower engine, and people loved it. I saw this and thought, why don't I see how far I can run with this idea? So I made my own from scratch, only more complicated and with actual gameplay. And everybody hated it. They accused me of plagiarising. I thought that it was obvious that I had been inspired by Red Enchilada's submission, since mine was released a few days later. But I had made mine from the beginning, and it would have been apparent had anybody tried my game, since it didn't suffer from any of the limitations or bugs that his had. From their point of view, I had stolen somebody else's work. From mine, I had run with an idea that otherwise wouldn't have gone anywhere. I was upset and angry. Just after that, I made Sundown Shambles. My housemate gave me very positive feedback and I genuinely enjoyed booting it up and playing it just to shoot some zombies. I had found it harder and harder to complete complicated games, but just about managed with this one thanks to a competition deadline that it was for. This was a side view platformer where you fought bats. You gained experience which you could then exchange for better weapons and equipment. It featured beautiful parallax graphics. Wind would blow through the grass and trees as you explored a twilight world to get to the bottom of a mystery. It was by far the biggest and most complicated game that I had made at that time. And in a way, this game summarised my main problem. I try to cram too much into my games. That itself isn't a problem, but it is if the features are buggy or don't work well together, which is what happened with Sundown Shambles. Okay, I added grass that you could shuffle through, but that led to slowdown on people's laptops, which detracted from the rest of the game. I added countless weapons, but most people couldn't figure out the controls to equip them. There was depth, but it wasn't user-friendly or obvious to somebody who hadn't already playtested it. And the reviews picked up on this, even though most people were really kind and gave it a good review anyway. But that didn't stop me from starting arguments with everybody who even hinted at problems with the game. Oh, please don't do this. Please. Why would I have done that? I am not proud of how I behaved back then. Don't get me wrong, I had good intentions. Every second I dedicated to making the game, I was hell-bent on making a masterpiece that would give everybody endless hours of enjoyment. I'd slave away over small details that most people would overlook. I'd big the game up in my head, imagining it driving me to fame and glory. Those bitter comments I wrote were me crashing back down to reality, defending my creation and trying to convince everybody that it was somehow perfect. It was inevitable that it had to happen at some point. It's just that the fall was so much harder thanks to those years of unreleased projects inflating my expectations. But like I said, it got mostly positive reviews and even won a small competition over on GameBuilder, which no longer exists. From the way I had responded to criticism, you'd have thought they had been criticised and publicly shamed by Gabe Newell himself. After this, I crawled off to lick my wounds, only for Geff Owns 2 to come out and to rub salt into each and every one of my many orifices. This was the opposite of Sundown Shambles. It was a basic, subpar platform game that replaced storyline for embarrassingly obvious ass-licking of Jeff, the maker of the Click products. You controlled him, shooting down the Game Maker and Construct, which were rivals to the Click products at the time. And everybody loved it for being humorous. It was like a popular version of the best game ever. It had clearly taken just hours to make, and yet it got more attention than any of my games ever had. Had I learned my lesson? Of course not. I dove straight into the comments section, attacking his attempt and making enemies with everybody left on the site. I was outraged at how it was making a mockery of Click products and the community around them. Let's pause here. I was wrong. You don't go around shooting down other people's stuff and praising your own. If anything, you should do the opposite. What I should have done was to take on board the criticism that I had received from Sundown Shambles and then to have studied why Jeff Owens did well. Perhaps I could have made a quick game from the remains of Sundown Shambles, removing the bits that didn't work and building on what did. It would have been awesome if it was a single screen where you had to battle against ever-increasing quantities of bats, with new, more powerful weapons being awarded every round. This sort of game would have combined what I did well with what the community wanted. It would be super awesome if I got in touch with Jeff himself and he helped me to implement a super complex online high score feature into this Jeff Owens beating platformer game. Actually, that's exactly what I did with Bat Spam, which I released just a few weeks later. It was great fun to play since it was effectively a version of what my Sundown Shambles playtesters had spent hours repeating over and over in the first place. This game was going to take the site by storm, but nobody bothered playing it. Aside from Mr. Tom and Aiden, who were my friends, it received a single 3 out of 5 rating from a guy who had criticised Sundown Shambles. His advice for Bat Spam? Add more levels, enemy types and gameplay features. The only other feedback I got was that it's hard to play on a trackball. Even though I hate who I was back then, this was harsh. I had tried everything. I had learned valuable game making lessons, but had no motivation to make them anymore. Perhaps it was the community's way of saying that I wasn't welcome there. I had become like Fizzy. And then something amazing happened. There was this guy on the site called James Luke. He couldn't spell. He had the wisdom of a 5-year-old and yet seemed so sweet and innocent, which I guess is why everybody was so nice to him. And then he began churning out rubbishy games. They were so bad, they must have been a parody of the ones that people seemed to love so much on that site. Each of his games would only have taken a matter of hours to make, and yet they were greeted with more and more positive feedback than my proper games ever had. What was he doing? This was when I had an idea. I created Deathgiver, the game that I made in 2 hours, and let him release it under his account. It got bad ratings, but since it was released by James Luke, I didn't care. I was just pleased that people were downloading and playing it. Unlike the criticism that my games had received, the comments that he got were fair and constructive, and I completely agreed with them. Deathgiver's release had given me so much more satisfaction than Sundown Shambles had, and I suspect is why I look back so much more fondly at the project. I do wonder how positive it would have been had I released the game myself. But this mysterious James Luke character didn't stop there. He dug deeper still. He made a game called Skimmer, where you pressed a button and watched an object bounce across the water for ages. Loads of people played it, even though they acknowledged that it wasn't very good. But they still took him seriously. Next, he submitted a game that was strangely like Jeff Owens 2 in every way, but worse. They still played it. His masterpiece was undoubtedly Road Rage, which is the worst game that I've ever played. I mean, you drove a car and had to jump over witches. By now, even the nicest of people on the site were struggling to think of positive things to say about his creations. But he was such a nice person. Who would be cold enough to destroy his dreams? This was a revelation for me in a number of ways. Being the sort of person to dispute any criticism, who thought that my games were superior to everybody else's, you might have thought that I would have hated James Luke for getting the credit for my most successful release. But I didn't. I happily saw the downloads and comments as a sign that people were playing my games, yet any negative feedback was absorbed by the James Luke name. I had glitched my brain. Secondly, I didn't mind the criticism because I knew that Deathgiver had its flaws. It was a simple, quick affair, and I saw a 3 out of 5 rating of the game that took me just hours to make as being a guaranteed success had I dedicated just a few more hours to polishing it. By comparison, I had no idea of what people wanted from my proper games, like Sundown Shambles or Don't Look Down, which was still not getting positive reviews even after weeks of development. To me, those games were perfect, or at least a lot closer to that status than other people's games, and I had no idea of how I was supposed to improve on them further. I learned that I should build things from the ground up, getting it to work on a basic level before elaborating on it, rather than starting with some obscure or absurdly complex idea and shoehorning it into something that people could play, relying on depth to compensate for lack of balance or fun. It wasn't that they hated my creations, it's just that they couldn't be bothered to play them. Even a simple skimming game made by a half-wit was more fun for them than one that required 5 minutes to learn. From his creations, I discovered what the world wanted from games. All I had to do now was to build on the foundations that he had laid, to listen to the feedback so that the project steered itself in the right direction, and perhaps more importantly, to then humbly release them and not to attack every bit of criticism they received. Easy. I was now building games from the ground up, rather than starting with a strange idea and shoehorning it into something that I thought people wanted to play. You remember that Deathgiver game I mentioned earlier? Before the 100,000 view video was removed from YouTube, it attracted thousands of people to the game on the daily click, making it one of the most downloaded games on the entire site. That's right, a game that took 2 hours to make, which was inferior to everything else in every way, outperformed every other game that I had ever made up to that point in time. And it wasn't even released by me, so I made a second one. It started its life in a similar vein to how the first one had. It took me 6 hours to make the game engine, and I intended to finish the rest within 20. But the game bloated in size. It took me longer and longer to complete it as I added more levels and polish to it. I took it seriously, complete with beautiful parallax backdrops and a number of different environments that were strung together by a story that James Luke could be proud of. And by that I mean that it was laughably bad. It included more spelling mistakes than a pirate story written by a child. Some levels turned out to be dreams. There's a torture scene where he escapes the moment a guard leaves the room. I think at one point he kills the internet. And in keeping with the first game, it features more helicopter crashes than a Michael Bay movie. And best of all, this was all narrated by an Irish guy named Savage, who's an interesting person in his own right, who would always link me to conspiracies and dodgy sites in his spare time, which he seemed to have a lot of. It was the best, worst game that I had ever made. It was only fitting that I contacted James Luke and gave him the honour of releasing it. It was met with critical acclaim, and to this day is among the 100 highest rated games on the site. Nobody questions the storyline, though one review site online warned downloaders of a swear word that I had slipped into the game about halfway through. It's completely out of character with the rest of the narrative, but it only adds to the comedy. Kudos to them for actually playing so far into the game. And that's the end of my dealings with James Luke. He spelt like a 7-year-old, made terrible games and stole my own. But from studying his creations, I learned how I could make my future titles successful, and for that, I'll always be grateful. Unfortunately, the site he uploaded his games to went out of business or whatever, so his creations have been lost forever, but I assure you that they weren't particularly worth playing. Apparently he's working on a third Deathgiver game now, but I doubt that it's ever going to be released, and dread to think of what it'll be like if it is. I stole the early artwork he made for it, and it's now been viewed over 1 million times. So I guess we're even.